Thank you for joining us wherever you are. This podcast episode is brought to you by the Old Ways Actual Play Team. This actual play uses the 7th edition Call of Cthulhu tabletop role-playing game rules by Chaosium. This actual play is performed by adults and in an adult setting. While we try very hard to stick to language for all ages, listeners should know that this podcast may include mature themes. All content, including names, places, events, companies, and etc., that may bear resemblance to entities living or dead, is strictly coincidental. My name is Michael Diamond, and for tonight's game, I will be your keeper. Thank you for joining us again on another episode of the Old Ways Podcast. I am your keeper, Keeper Michael, and we return to Masks of Nyarlathotep in our Kenya chapter. As we'd like to do at the top of the show, we'd like to thank you, the listener, and especially you, the Patreon supporter. If you haven't had a chance to check out what we have to offer, you can at patreon.com/theoldwayspodcast. We are surging towards 1,000 subscribers on YouTube. We'd like you to be a part of that as well. So if you're not, please go over and join us on YouTube. The Old Ways Podcast, simple and easy to find, plus all of our additional video content is there as well. And now we're going to get to investigator introductions. We will do so to my right.
This is Tiffany, and I play Maeve O'Shea, and oopsie.
Yeah, basically. Sort of had a large oopsie here last night at dinner, and may have, you know, accidentally made a few party members sleepy. That's okay. I'm sure that they'll get over it at some point. To Miss O'Shea's right.
This is Morgan. I play Lillian Lane, and I have hopefully had a good night's rest and have also gotten my handy-dandy King in Yellow back where it belongs.
I'm certain that the King will not leave you. That as much is certain. At the end of the table.
Hello, this is Jake. I'll be playing Jack Doyle, and we get to do some investigating today. Really happy. Well,
I sure hope so. Investigating is sort of the thing that you're supposed to be doing, and that certainly would prove useful in the future. To Mr. Doyle's right.
This is Lonnie. I'm playing Robert Drummond, and I'm currently having a nap of Nyarlathotep.
Yes, indeed. After that exquisite dinner last night, you got relatively sleepy, we'll just say quickly, and may have drooled into your own table. It's possible. We are in the missing Dr. Tottenbach formation for this episode, but trust that he will be back very shortly to cure all your ails. Last, but most certainly not least.
This is Alex playing Sam Berlong, who has gotten some wardrobe enhancements on his stay here.
Yes, you've pilfered a policeman, or at least their clothing. All right. Speaking of Sam, we're going to raise the curtain tonight on morning at the mission. So last episode, Sam decided to go back to Swahili Town. He managed to find a mission there that was run by a gentleman named Dr. Starrett, and he found a place to stay and slept for a few hours. The morning arrives pretty early here at the mission. People are probably up before 5. So you've likely gotten, we'll just say, about 3 to 4 hours of sleep. You'll recover a single hit point rather than the 2 that you normally would because you've had about half a night's rest.
Okay.
And you're able to, I mean, you weren't bothered in the night. Everybody here was pretty pleasant. It was sort of a steamy, I guess, evening. And you're awake.
I won't waste much time. I'll seek out Dr. Starrett, whom I met last night. Say to him, I apologize for arriving at such a late hour, but my arrival in Nairobi has been busy, to say the least. I do appreciate the peace and hospitality afforded me.
Yeah, Starrett nods. He seems to have a different air about him than a lot of the people who've come here. He has a deep sort of understanding, just visually. This likely comes from, you imagine anyway, likely comes from the sheer number of people that he has to help on a regular basis. He's a missionary, and he's clearly not native. He has the countenance of a medical doctor.
So I was going to ask, out of curiosity, are you a physician by trade or an academic?
Well, I'm a physician. I'm a medical doctor. And he gives you a slight smile, an Anglican rector.
Oh, lovely. I would presume then that you've cared for a great many people that have come through here, whether by necessity or circumstance. I'm loath to ask this, but there was a pretty grievous incident recently on a train involving a horrifying victim in a mail car. Were you aware of this?
I was made aware that there was an incident on the train. Several of the local people, local Nairobians and those who were up from Mombasa came to the mission early yesterday, gave me a series of wild explanations about things that had happened there. I helped what I could, where I could.
Is there anybody like actively listening to our conversation, or we kind of, do I feel like I could speak relatively candidly?
It seems so. There are people milling about, there are people moving about their day, but it doesn't look like anybody around is sort of sitting and focused on the two of you.
Well, I have reason to believe he was slaughtered in most grievous fashion. His tongue had been removed from his body.
He sort of steadies himself a little bit. There have been stories, tales of certain practices, cultural practices here that are one might see something like that in.
Well, I understand how improper it must be, but I need you to understand I'm not inquiring out of morbid curiosity. I have an interest in seeing these types of murders come to an end, and I have my own suspicions who may be responsible. A dear friend of mine lost his life hoping to do the same. Have you encountered any of these types of scenes before? These bizarre murders?
I have seen several different instances of encounters here in the space beyond. I have, unfortunately, as a newcomer to these lands, had to experience many of these situations firsthand, in the sense that as a doctor, the people come to me. It is natural. They come to the mission for all manner of things. I'm not so I am not so young enough and naive to think that they only come for God's word. They come for what they need in the moment. People are generally very simple. They have simple needs.
Well, then allow me to be very direct, Doctor. If there's anything you can tell me about these types of strange circumstances that have arisen, that have come to your attention, whether recently or in recent history, I would deeply appreciate any insight you could offer.
I don't normally speak of them because it's a sensationalist topic here that is long quieted, but as you may or may not be aware, several years ago, there were a group of foreigners who came here on an expedition who were murdered in a very grisly fashion.
You know about the Carlisles?
Well, certainly.
I look around again, like immediately. I don't like usher him off. I just kind of, I definitely straighten up. You know, like I tighten up quite a bit.
Yeah. He doesn't seem to be off put by talking about it. And even any sort of feint or attempt to you know, block him or move him or he seems pretty rigid at this point.
Okay, good. You feel safe here. That's awesome.
He says, I participated in the medical examination of certain bodies returned to Nairobi for burial.
Oh. Well, there's there's someone who I'm here with that would, I'm sure, want deeply to speak with you on such matters, but I wouldn't want to necessarily pry or put you in a position to divulge anything that you didn't want to. What can you tell me?
He takes probably a moment or so and does a cursory examination of not only you, but the scene, the area. He says, let us walk in the garden.
Of course.
He steps out from the mission and walks through a side door into a very small but reasonably tended garden. There's some vegetables being grown here, and then there's also just a natural garden space. There are some statuary pieces here as well, clearly aligning with the Anglican faith. I found it strange, what was brought back. Sort of astonishingly so fresh. For, well, pieces, which supposedly had been laid on the ground for months. They should have been devoured by animals, surely. Or thoroughly rotted, given the time between death and discovery. It confirmed in me, in my faith, a brush of the devil's hand doomed them. I believe what ended them was nothing less than supernatural evil.
I hate to ask, who have you shared that with? That theory?
Oh, the authorities. I left my report with the authorities. They required it to be... He sort of firms his jaw. Suitably inconclusive. You see, I can tell you for one clear fact. There were no Caucasians among the dead.
So none of the expedition other than the workers died there.
The authorities didn't want to hear it. He sort of folds his arms over his chest.
I could not have expected to. I'm sorry that you had to see what you saw.
I've seen the horrors of man before. This was something different. I think the relief I had was that there were no Caucasians among the dead. I say that not in any disrespect, of course, but Miss Masters was here. She was not well. She came to me. They came to me to purchase medical supplies, specific ones, which were, because of their nature, unavailable at the local chemist shops. In return, Miss Masters generously donated to the work of the church, which I will always be forever grateful for.
I can only assume you were generous.
It didn't take too long to ferret out that Miss Masters was suffering with something. And that the head of the expedition, Roger, was deeply concerned about how much pain she was in. I provided them the things that he needed. Basic medical supplies plus petroleum jelly, opium, so on.
Well, look, Doctor, I don't know how much I can offer you, save that the information you provided me will be put to use, I promise. If there's anything I can do, There is a doctor that I travel with, again, who a physician as well, and a psychiatrist, a German man, delightful to work with, who I'm sure would love to speak with you, given the opportunity, if the opportunity presents itself. If you're willing.
Well, certainly. I have nothing. I don't have much more, of course. We could talk about medical impressions, of course, because he's a medical doctor, but...
It's a bit outside of my domain.
Certainly. If he is willing to lend his assistance, I'm more than happy to take it. Clearly, the mission does help many people. And trained medical workers are very difficult to come by.
I am confident it would take a little persuading to get him here.
Oh. If he is a medical doctor, I am certain that that is true. I spend most of my days concerned with people like yourself who are new to Nairobi, who might be taking chances. I give lectures. African diseases, venomous snakes, spiders, frogs, what suitable precautions could be taken, that sort of thing.
Well, if you're aware of the types of things that might be at work here, I also need you to understand, as much as I might like to return, I would hate to put you or anyone here in danger. So please understand that if you don't see me again, it's not because I lack a desire to learn more.
I wouldn't assume so. Besides, I have nothing on earth to fear.
I will allow myself to smile. Thank you.
I have many to look after. I hope your rest was useful.
More than enough. Thank you again for your hospitality.
He adjusts his wire rim glasses and, leads you back inside to the actual exit. And you'll head off to breakfast?
Yep.
So breakfast for the rest of you, and soon for Sam, is a pretty interesting event. Miss O'Shea, you wake up well-rested.
I'm sure that I do.
Mm-hmm. Yep, absolutely. So everybody who got the full night's rest who needs the hit points can have 2 hit points back, which will put you in a little bit better position, Miss Lane.
Yes.
Obviously, you, Robert, don't need any. And those of you who were down MP from last night, recover 1 per hour. We'll say that you get more than 5 hours of sleep, so you should be okay. So breakfast is a little different than you're used to. I think the first thing you probably notice at breakfast is there are some staple foods here, right? So you're going to get eggs. There are, probably pork is available fairly readily. Mandazi are also here. That's a deep fried dough. And then you get to try vibibi, which are rice coconut pancakes.
Those sound delicious.
Yeah. And they also have sweet bananas here. There are also kaimati, which are sweet dumplings that are assorted well. It's a pretty bolstering breakfast. But over this breakfast, including tea and coffee, are an assembly of investigators. So... including Sam.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Is it time for breakfast?
It is. It's a hearty breakfast.
I will join them at their table. Looking like I don't know, saw a ghost.
Mm-hmm. Morning, Sam. Find out anything interesting?
I look for coffee.
Yep, it's here.
I drink a lot of it first. Hot or not, and just kind of wipe my mouth on my sleeve. I just got back from a mission in Swahili town. I met a Dr. Starrett, delightful man. who had much to say about the Karlev expedition. After I had inquired about, he cares for many in the area, and I had inquired about whether he'd seen any victims that matched, you know, the mail carrier on the train, who had their tongues removed. And after being pressed a little bit about other things he had seen, he brought up the Carlisle expedition, as apparently he was the physician that worked on the bodies that were brought in, or what remained of them.
Well, that's convenient.
I would say not for him. He said that after months of them baking in the sun, that the pieces hadn't even been eaten by wildlife and that there were no European victims among them. He also made it pretty clear that the authorities wanted the information in their report kept vague.
Mm-hmm.
He seems aware and at least convinced that the supernatural was at play. But again, you know, the authorities being the authorities, I don't imagine that theory went very far. But that was this morning. I mean, I'd spent the day scouting around, and I saw plenty, but I'm still a little taken aback by, I mean, that what he had to do, what he had to see to just continue his work is pretty remarkable. Anyway, as far as the city is concerned, it's, you know, the center seems to be where most of the activity happens, including the police presence. And the areas to the south and southeast are where most of the locals have been sequestered. And the build-out of the colony seems to be blooming north and northwest. It's broken up into districts for Indians, Asians, and I guess the tribes to the south, colloquially referred to as Swahili town and Somali town. And there's a race course nearby, which I didn't expect to see given how recent this place is. But yes, I suppose everybody needs a hobby, but yes, there's a horse race track. And it also seems the Bank of England has wasted no time setting up shop in the heart of Nairobi.
Oh, sure. Bankers always follow civilization around.
I didn't go so far as to venture into the wilderness, but if I'm being honest, I'm seriously considering making a trip into the woodlands and finding a place to set up camp out of the way.
Well, we'll be heading out that way soon enough, I'm sure. I found out that there is a man called Endicott who runs a hunting lodge that the Carlisle expedition spent some days at. That might be an interesting individual to talk to.
Do we know what they were doing there?
Well, I'm assuming hunting. But, you know, there could be any number of things they were doing out there.
One thing to mention, and I don't know if we think it might be valuable, but I am a little keen on getting my hands on that report. And I think I have a way to retrieve them.
No, if you think you can get a hold of it, then that might help. Of course, I don't know if they're keeping it vague. They may not have any interesting information in there.
No, perhaps not. Is Dr. Tottenbach awake?
I think he said he was going to take a stroll about town this morning.
Question for the keeper.
Yes.
So what was the name of the guy that Alex spoke to?
Dr. Starrett.
Okay. Because I've got a mark in here. Mark Selkirk also found the bodies undecayed.
Maybe that's an initial finder?
Yeah. So we might want to find him too. Just to corroborate or see if he has more information.
Yeah. If we could find him.
Right.
If he was first on the scene, if anybody would make their way out of Nairobi, it's probably that person.
Or was that in Shanghai, the asylum that Carlisle is said to be in or escaped from?
That was in Hong Kong.
That was in Hong Kong. So we think he came here. Or we're hoping.
That's what we're assuming.
Okay. Came back here, right? Because they would have had to have left here first.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Jack took him and they fled Kenya here. That's where they ended up in China. And afterwards, after he escaped, we believe Carlisle has come back this way.
Starrett had also mentioned a woman that had come through that was ill. What was her name? I didn't write it.
There was only a couple of Hypatia Masters.
Masters, yes, that was the name. She had donated, and they had provided some medical supplies because she was not doing well. She had taken ill or something, but they had mentioned opiates and petroleum jellies and all sorts of other medical supplies that the expedition had purchased from the mission.
Okay. All right. Well, let's review what we have so far. Carlisle Expedition stayed at the Hampton House for a few days. They left there and went to the hunting lodge.
Yeah, just so we're clear, you're sitting in the Hampton House.
The Hampton House, yeah. They went to the hunting lodge for a few days. And after that, they must have left for... So after that, they must have... What must have been when they headed to the Aberdare Forest?
Correct.
So they'd have had to have gone to the mission somewhere between staying here and the lodge, right? Or
maybe when they're here.
Or after, sure.
You know, they stayed here, I don't know, 2-3 days. Maybe at some point in those 2-3 days, they went to the mission, got the medical supplies, and then for some reason headed to the hunting lodge.
We also have a Mr. Harvest we can speak to. He was the speaker for the colony for the trial of the murder, you know, when they wrongfully accused some people while we're here.
Keeper, if I may, I'm going to go ahead and write a note to leave in the doctor's room or for the doctor at the desk if they'll take it. That will outline like the name of the mission, its location, and indicate that, you know, they are very interested in taking advantage of or utilizing his medical services.
Okay. Yeah, absolutely. It's not hard. I don't imagine... I'm going to imagine that Sigmund probably locks his room, but I mean...
I can always slide under the door.
Frankly, yeah, it's pretty simple.
Okay. Yeah, I'll leave him a note. It sounds like something he might want to do.
Okay.
What else do we have?
We just want to be aware of Kenyatta, because we're pretty... From what I've read, I'm pretty sure that's the person we're up against.
Kenyatta? Is this a person?
Yeah, he's a Kenyan nationalist with ties to the cult of the Bloody Tongue.
Oh, okay.
How do we know that he has ties? Because I thought we were up against... Is it... I keep forgetting the guy's name. Is it Roger?
No, I don't think we're up against him. I think we are traveling the same destination.
Mm-hmm. But we're also assuming that he's off of his... he's out of his mind.
Yeah.
I mean, literally, what has he got to come back for?
Well, if he's connected to Nyarlathotep, then he may be drawn here.
It actually goes... back a little further than that. So it goes in the Wayback Machine back to a room. And that room is room 410 in the Chelsea Hotel, where you grabbed some papers off of Elias's working desk. And there were notes on those. There were 8 sets of notes in Elias's papers. One of the Nairobi notes lists offices, officials, and tribes that Elias visited searching for materials concerning the cults and cult rituals. Elias mentioned Roger Corden, the colonial undersecretary for internal affairs.
Mm-hmm. I have that written down.
However, he notes that nothing conclusive was learned. Elias discounts the official version of the Carlisle massacre. That's the first time he questions it. The second set of notes describes his trip to the massacre site. He notes particularly that the earth there is completely barren and that all of the tribes of the region avoid the place, saying it is cursed by the god of the black wind, whose home is in a nearby mountaintop. The third set of Elias's notes is an interview with Johnstone Kenyatta, who says that the Carlisle murders may have been performed by the cult of the Bloody Tongue. He says that the cult is reportedly based in the mountains and that its high priestess is part of the Mountain of the Black Wind. Elias is politely skeptical, but Kenyatta insists upon the point. In quotes, Elias records that regional tribes fear and hate the Bloody Tongue, that the tribal magic is of no protection against the cult, and that the cult's god is not of Africa. Set 4 follows up on the Kenyatta interview. Elias confirms from several good sources that the Bloody Tongue exists, though he finds no firsthand evidence of it. Tales include children stolen for sacrifice. Creatures with great wings are said to come down from the Mountain of the Black Wind to carry people off. The cult worships a god unknown to folklorists, one fitting no traditional African pattern. Elias lists Sam Mariga Railway Station, Neville Jermyn, Dr. Starrett, Lieutenant Selkirk, and Colonel Endicott as people he questioned. So set 5 is a single sheet reminding Elias that the Cairo-based portion of the Carlisle itinerary must be examined carefully. He believes that the reason which prompted Carlisle's Kenyan side trip is on the Nile. Set 6 is a long interview with Lieutenant Mark Selkirk, leader of the men who actually found the remains of the Carlisle expedition. Importantly, Selkirk says that the bodies were remarkably undecayed for the length of time which they lay in the open, almost as if decay itself wouldn't come near the place. Secondly, the victims had been torn apart as if by animals, though what sorts of animals would pull apart bodies so systematically he could not guess. Unimaginable, inexplicable. Selkirk agrees that the Nandis may have had something to do with the episode, but suspects that the charges against the ringleaders were trumped up. Quote, "It wouldn't be the first time," he said cynically. Finally, Selkirk confirms that no Caucasians were found amongst the dead. Only the corpses of Kenyan bearers were scattered across the barren plain, despite what was claimed at the inquest, the trial. Set 7 of Elias's notes is another single sheet. Elias ran into Nails Nelson at the Victoria Bar in Nairobi. Nelson had been a mercenary for the Italians on the Somali-Abyssinian border and had escaped into Kenya after double-crossing his employers. Nelson claimed to have seen Jack Brady alive in Hong Kong less than 2 years before Elias was in Kenya and long after the Kenyan court declared that Brady and the rest of the expedition were dead. Brady was friendly, though guarded. Nelson didn't press the conversation. This report is what helped strengthen Elias's belief that the principal members of the expedition might still be alive. And then set 8 is basically Elias's notes of him forming what he was going to call the Carlisle book, which was the book on the entire expedition and what actually happened. There is your season 2 masks info bump.
Yeah, I think that was on my computer. But yes, it makes sense now why I have these other notes and everybody else is like, really? Who are these people? And I was like, no, but I found this. I remember I found it.
Yeah, it's from a really long time ago.
Yeah.
So the notes would have not made a connection between Kenyatta being a member of the Bloody Tongue.
No, he knew about the Bloody Tongue.
Right. Okay. And believed that they were real.
Okay. So we do have people to speak to.
Yeah. If we can find them.
How much of is all this being divulged? I'm just going to
Yeah. I would break down like.
Okay. So it, it sounds like if we wanted to talk to someone who might be sympathetic, Kenyatta might be among them.
Him and Selkirk for sure. And now thinking about the forest and the mountain, I think that's what feels off. I bet you, because that it is said that where they were found, that earth is completely blackened.
Right.
And if winged creatures are coming from the mountain, that means they probably have, is it Baki? Is that how they're?
Bianchi.
Yeah, Bianchi. Which is similar to, or was, what what's his name was flying that Lillian shot out of the sky.
Well, that or hunting horrors. Or
while this recitation of information is likely very helpful for people like, well, everybody, but especially Mr. Drummond, who was not aware of any of this, I think for you, Robert, one of the things you're going to draw to is that experience from going and getting your camera, which is there has to be a paper around here, right?
Yeah. I'm sure there's some sort of local news. And this is the Carlisle expedition was probably one of the biggest things that happened in the area outside of like the Lion of Savo, which I think happened a little while ago as well.
Mm-hmm.
So are we considering looking for even more leads? Is that what I'm hearing? Because I just heard like a laundry list of them.
Well, I mean, that's what we have for this area. Now, I mean, I think some of it depends on who we talk to and what they say, how much information we want. I mean, the biggest thing for us is we're going after that priestess, and right. I'm sure we'll find Carlisle there, because I'm sure he's drawn to whatever she's got going on. We got to find somebody who knows who she is.
I guess I'll say this much. And I kind of hinted at it when he came here, and I'm not going to push it too much, but I would like to make very, very clear that we are being hunted. So bear in mind that anyone we talk to will become a target.
It's been that way. It's either that or we go off the information we have and we just march to that mountain. I mean,
I'm just saying, I would like to select for people who, if we are going to talk to them, might have a chance at being somewhat prepared for what might happen.
Just would say that whoever is around here that's local that was here at the time of the Carlisle incident, it's been how many years since the Carlisle incident and they're still walking around breathing?
It's been one day since the train. Okay, we just got here and we put dozens of people's lives in danger by arriving. Don't play this down, Robert. It's not worth it.
I'm not playing it down. I'm just merely saying that if they want, if whoever this cult is or whoever actually did the killings of the people in the Carlisle expedition wanted people dead, they've been here for years. If they're still alive right now, it's obviously not a pressing issue for them.
They want us dead now. Is that not clear to you? It is a pressing issue now because we are here now.
Okay, but you talked to the doctor this morning at the mission, so now his life is in danger. What are we going to do about that?
No one knows I was there.
Nobody was supposed to know we were on the train either, but...
You don't paint a very quiet picture as a group. When I travel alone, I trust that no one knows where I'm going or where I've been.
So... You're saying what, we should just send you off to speak to everybody then?
No, I'm saying we should be careful with who we choose. Damn it.
Okay, but anybody that we choose is going to be in danger. We don't know who's going to be prepared and who's not.
Why don't we make a plan of what we're going to do next?
Well, apparently not talk to anybody.
Like I said, you can choose any human shields you want. We are generally ill-content to make human sacrifices, but it seems we are not. So let us go about our way.
Well, I think we need to be smart about what we're going to do next. Of course, we don't want to put people in undue, you know, in harm's way.
Perhaps we just warn them about what is coming their way if they talk to us after they talk to us?
I don't think that there's really a good option. I mean, unfortunately. So the best case is pick some of these people that have been in the military, because then they would have some experience fighting other people if somebody comes after them. That would be the only other option. Otherwise, we don't speak to anybody and we go on the information that we have just to keep other people safe. And that also means that we should stay out of town, because if anybody comes this way, there's going to be casualties. I hate it too. I'm not saying that, like, you know, collateral damage is just, you know, whatever, but like, I don't know how we're going to finish what we have started if we don't have enough information.
Okay, so we have to track down these people. The two or three we've chosen. And we can make a decision after we find out if they're even still here.
So Kenyatta's a local national, right? So he's a public figure.
Right. But that doesn't mean he's here. He could be in, you know, Basa. He could be out in the field somewhere.
No, it depends on if he's representing local tribes or who he's a representative of or what have you.
Well, we could always check the paper first to see if he's still in the area. They would, if he's a big figure here, he would undoubtedly, his movements would be something of note.
Sure.
Okay, so post-breakfast then, and not post-Brexit for those of you who are listening in the UK, post-breakfast, where of the many places you could go, where are we aiming?
Well, first we'll start, we'll aim for a local paper.
Okay. So, relatively easy to find. Again, remember that Nairobi is not very big. So while they're not the only paper in town, a place that is fairly close is the Nairobi Star.
On the way there, I'd like to buy a good pair of boots.
Easily done.
Excellent.
Easily done. So from the hotel, it's really right across City Square Park, and you find the Nairobi Star. A bustling hub of information and things to know about local Nairobi culture and population. It's the Star is probably not some vaunted, enormous building. It's a newspaper. So there's probably a space for the printing press itself. And then there's some desks and typewriters, likely a couple of reporters. It's a moderately sized building.
I suppose it goes worth mentioning. I'm not taking any chances. I will not be following the investigators inside. I'll be staying outside and watching like a hawk.
You meet a tall and slender woman, Jack. She wears her hair in a bun. She comes out to sort of step into the outer office area. And she greets you with a smile and she says, welcome to the Nairobi Star. Can I help you?
We could use some information about some of your locals.
Well, they're not mine. They're everyone's, of course.
Well, of course.
Anything specific?
There's a couple of people we were asked to talk to. A Mr. Selkirk.
Is
he still in town? Do you know?
I think it's very likely that Mr. Selkirk is probably still in town. Why don't you step back to my office here and we can get some particular details.
Oh, of course.
So you, Jack, and just the four of you then?
Yeah, the four of us.
Okay.
We cut down the numbers enough.
She's more than happy to have you in the office. There's luckily enough chairs for everybody. She adjusts the bun a little bit that she has set on top of her head. Well, what specific?
Well, we're actually following up on the Carlisle expedition. That story that came out a few years ago.
Okay. She takes a pencil out and a piece of like a folded piece of paper and starts making notes.
And we were just there was a few people that we needed to interview.
All right.
Mr. Selkirk, of course. Kenyatta.
Kenyatta, huh?
Yes.
Just so you're aware, Kenyatta can produce a lot of opinions. I think that's sort of the best way to put it. He's working very hard from a political perspective to gain a voice for his people.
Mm-hmm.
And some people see that as rabble-rousing.
Of course.
Other people see it as political dissidents. The British don't treat him very kindly.
I'm sure.
All right, so Kenyatta, he's got offices here in Nairobi. You could go talk to him. Not hard to find at all. That's one man not hard to find.
Oh, excellent. And we heard about this Colonel Endicott that runs a hunting lodge or something out this way.
Yeah, I've heard of him.
Would you know how to get a hold of him? Does he have I mean, if he's renting this lodge, or what's going on with that?
I'm fairly certain that he owns the lodge, if memory serves correctly. The hunting lodge, though, is something you'd have to travel to specifically. He very rarely comes into town at all. But I might be able to put you in contact with him.
That would be very appreciated.
At least by letter. And then, of course, if you said that you're looking into the Carlisle expedition?
Yes. You know, people are always interested in the things that have happened and, you know, follow-up information.
Well, I mean, I'm certain that you could look into the files here. I mean, we covered the arrival of the Carlisle expedition while they were here.
Oh, would that be all right with you?
Yeah, certainly. As long as two things are completely clear for everybody. None of the papers or photographs leave here.
Mm-hmm, of course.
It's the only record that we have. And then two, any investigative work or writing that you might do afterwards would credit us with the material.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Any investigative writing will definitely credit the Nairobi Star.
She smiles. Well, I appreciate that. I can show you to the records room if you'd like.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Carlisle people were a little strange, kind of unhealthy.
That's what we've heard.
Yeah. I remember Hypatia being very sick. They didn't want us to photograph her.
Hmm. Oh, you talked to them yourself?
Very, very briefly, yeah. Mostly because, what was his name? Sir Aubrey was very particular about, I don't know, he sort of strutted around like he was a rooster.
Hmm.
He had a very definitive way of doing things. I think he might have been a little egotistical, you know.
I would have thought that Roger Carlisle would have been more of the rooster.
You know, I scarcely saw Roger. I just remember him being a young, nervous man. He liked whiskey. And I remember, she sort of puts her finger to her chin. I remember Tan Kor, little slimy woman, was at Hampton House a lot. She's runs a tea house, Indian lady. But I found it strange that this tea peddler was associating with a peer. I mean, Sir Aubrey is a peer of the realm.
Right.
They don't really, the social ladder there is a little bit of a stretch. She's still in Nairobi.
Is she?
Mm-hmm. If they got a chance to talk, maybe she could shed some light on what was going on.
I might have to look into it.
You're not the first person to ask me about the Carlisle expedition, of course.
Oh, yeah?
Hmm. Yeah. I talked to a gentleman a few years afterwards about it. He came here looking and poking around.
Would that be a Jackson Elias?
I think that's his name. Yeah, from America?
Yes.
Yeah. You know, if I didn't know it any better, he was poking around about them, but he was really concerned about something. He didn't want to let on, but when you've got a reporter's eye, you sort of pick out those things. He was really concerned about whatever they did here. And then, you know, obviously the tragedy is something that we all remember. Let me show you to the newspaper records. She gets up and walks towards the records room.
Do they have a gentleman's club here in Nairobi?
Not officially. She kind of cocks an eyebrow at you.
Hmm. Not officially?
Well, it's pretty clear, if it's not clear to you already, that the British Empire wants Nairobi to look like one thing. They want you to get off the train. They want you to see the pretty hotels. They want you to see the bank and the church, and they want you to see the beautiful houses on the hill, right? What they don't want you to see is Swahili town, Somali town, all of the industry and the muck that goes on behind there. There's a reason why they built the town the way they did. They want you to look at the mountains and the beautiful spaces and, you know, the continuation of the empire. They don't want you to see what goes on behind. She opens the door to the records room. This is the last 15 or so years of the newspaper. You're welcome to it.
Thank you very much.
She steps out.
Everybody looking at me to roll library use?
Well, yeah. I think we're going to spread out and roll library use.
Well, I have a 31 out of 97.
Ooh, I have an 1 out of 75.
Nice.
Take 5 points of luck, Mr. Doyle. Are you assisting Miss Lane, or are you just going to hang out?
Battered and bruised.
Same thing goes for you, Mr. Drummond, of course.
I have a 20 out of 70.
Ooh, I got a 18 out of 50.
Okay. I'm going to work on passing out some of these beautiful newspaper handouts that our friends at the H.P. Lovecraft Historical Society have prepared for us. Hand that down to Jack, if you would, Ms. O'Shea. And then you can take this one and then go ahead and hand this one to Miss Lane. So over the next hour or so, you begin to locate little bits and pieces of the Carlisle Expedition story in the newspaper here. So the actual written printed articles, many of those you probably have seen copies of, but these are the actual articles. You're not left out, of course, Mr. Drummond, just because you're not physically here. You do find an article on the hanging of the Nandi murderers, the people who were condemned for the killings.
The Fall Guys.
For your part, Sam, while this investigation is going on, why don't you give me a spot hidden roll at a hard difficulty?
That is not going to do it. That is a 75 under 85, so it's a success, but I can't spend down for that. That's way too much luck.
The Hand of Fate is going to make that a success.
Thank you. Or not. Nothing hard to see is worth seeing.
There is definitely someone across the street there who is sitting like behind some boxes or crates or something like that. And there's a lot of people moving around, milling around on the street in front of them. And they are 100% using those people as cover so that we can look at the Nairobi Star.
Okay, so I guess I will do my part to stay out of their eye line and try to get a better view of them. So I will like move to cross the street to be on their side of the street so that I can see them maybe from the side.
Mm-hmm.
Or, you know, if they're backs to a wall, I'm not gonna be able to like flank them or anything. But if I could see them from the side or get a different angle on them, I will spy on the spy if I might try.
Okay.
What can I identify anything about them, or can I just see that there is someone there, something doing something?
You pick up on the presence of being stared at, or people staring in the general direction, and it's sort of like your vision hones in across a park.
I see.
And you see that that person is sort of unflinchingly staring in your direction. And what gives you the, what sort of makes your skin crawl is the fact that that person is wearing a head wrapping, which is not uncommon here, of course, in Nairobi. But you begin to have these flashes of being on top of a train at night and seeing something like this illuminated in flames.
Oh, no.
And you're worried, immediately worried.
So when you say in my direction, you mean like at the building?
Yeah.
I don't carry rifle anymore. It's not really how I roll at this point. But I will do as I said. I will try to get a better position on them, and I will hunker down myself. And then once I feel like I have a position that I can get, not comfortable in, but that I can settle into, I will slowly take out my field glasses. Mm-hmm. And I want to enhance.
You go to enhance. You slowly take out your field glasses. The crowd shifts and moves a few times over there because the position they've taken up is near the market entrance. And so the amount of foot traffic and cart traffic is just tons. When you take out your field glasses and you look in at that area, at that space carefully, they've vanished.
So my pulse immediately races. And I will tuck them away. And then if I start looking for them, I'm probably not going to have time. So I don't run, but I hustle. Yeah, there's probably only one entrance, huh?
Yeah, that you know of.
Then I will do my best to use the crowd to my advantage and try to slip into the newspaper printer shop as quickly as I can without sprinting.
Okay. So by now, the investigators inside have managed to locate these articles. You can feel free to enlighten one another should you so choose.
I have pretty much the main story that they published, apparently, which gives us most of the same stuff we had before. There's a little bit in here. Apparently, it was when they went on safari, they said they were going to the Great Rift Valley, but their bodies were found nowhere near it.
Supposedly, according to the article I have, they were captured and been led to the area for a ritual sacrifice.
Well, we know that wasn't true.
Well, I mean, it probably was true, but it wasn't them. They probably performed it.
Do any of the four of you have the medicine skill?
I have it at one.
It's better than zero.
Everybody has it at one, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I would just say amongst the things that you find a picture, a departure photo from Nairobi, which includes Sir Aubrey looking exceptionally young.
Right. Is it another picture of Hypatia looking awful?
Yeah, it is.
And him look. Does he look younger than the last picture we saw?
Yes.
Okay. Because if you remember, I had a theory about that I talked to everybody about.
Mm-hmm.
That he eats her?
Yeah, basically.
How do I want to say this? The book is calling for a medicine roll, but I'm going to, at Keeper's discretion, change this. Miss Lane, you're the one that finds the photo.
Okay. I'll lean over and show it to Maeve because she's the one that originally talked about, the last picture and
certainly
her theories. So I kind of pointed out to her.
Make both of you make me
Mythos.
It's not a mythos roll.
Like a power roll for magic?
Yeah. No, not a power. I'm going to say an int roll.
An int roll? Oh, okay.
Okay.
But not as intelligence. We'll just call this an intuition roll.
Oh, okay. Cool. That's a 38 out of 90.
Mm-hmm.
A 36 out of 75.
Now, Miss O'Shea, you don't have any sisters, right? Albeit the stepsister that you inherited during gameplay.
Right.
And if memory serves correctly, you don't have any sisters either, Miss Lane.
I do not.
Brothers. That being said, Hypatia's wearing exceptionally bulky clothing.
Okay. Like she's cold?
No.
Like she's hiding something.
Correct. And so, like, when the two of you look at that photo, you're like...
Oh, we did talk about that, too.
Jack talked. It's a theory that Jack has.
Yeah, that's right.
You're like, first of all, Hypatia in all the other photos has been dressed appropriately for the 20s. She's also someone who has a fashion sense about her because if you remember the Wayback Machine, She has a, she was a model at one point.
Right, right.
And she was a photographer.
Well, that's why it seemed really, like, it stuck out that she started looking so poorly.
Right. This picture of her looks like she is perhaps several months along and she's doing her best to hide things.
Right. Yeah, that was Jack's theory that the baby was potentially feeding off of her and making her sick. And this might be the child that's supposed to be born at that. Yeah.
I mean, if that's true and it's not going to be born until, what,
January,
I can only imagine what she must look like now.
So it's been gestating for like 6 years.
Yeah. And she looked that bad then.
I mean, babies are little parasites, but.
Mm-hmm. I mean, this is ridiculous.
My article also, I mean, aside from that jarring picture, doesn't really say anything. It talks about where they went in Cairo and stuff, which we already visited. Mm-hmm. The only thing it mentions is that they were going to move the expedition to the Kenyan Highlands. According to Dr. Houston, it was not going to be purely for recuperation. So he said that a religious figure from early dynastic Egypt was rumored to have migrated southward with his people, possibly to this region. So.
Well, I think that would make some amount of sense.
Mm-hmm.
Sam, you enter the newspaper.
I look for the first member of the party that I can see.
That's sort of like the troubling portion for you when you enter, is that they are behind closed doors at this point.
Is there anyone up here?
I mean, there are office workers, yeah. A couple people typing away.
A group just came in here. Where did they go?
The woman looks up at you curiously and she points to a door like at this side of the building.
I'm running now that I'm inside. I just run.
Okay.
Toward the door. And when I get there, I will throw it open. And I again look for someone who I know, a face I know.
Look, you see four faces that you know.
I look at all of them and I say, we're out of time. We have to go. They're here.
Who?
Whoever was at the train. We have to go.
All right.
I lost them in the street.
All right, I finished taking notes on what I was reading and we'll talk about it back at the hotel.
Pack everything up.
Okay, you pack everything up.
Did I see another way out of here?
Yeah, there's a back door.
Yeah, I head toward the back door.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll go. We'll follow. I mean,
yeah.
That's reasonable.
You head towards the back door. Information having acquired. You get to the back door. You're heading out the back door, Sam, or are you getting to it?
Well, I will get to it, make sure I see all of the faces I need to see. And I'm ignoring anybody inside who seems concerned about what we're doing. And I will open the back door a bit, get a look out there, and then see what I can see. Is it like an alley, or is it just another street?
It's an alley.
Okay. Then I will open the door and usher everyone out.
Right. Is there anybody else out here?
No, it's just you guys.
Okay. Walk right out into ambush.
Yeah.
That'd be fun.
I mean, this isn't Shadowrun. Let me get my D6 singing.
Son of a...
So you exit out of the side or the back of the Nairobi Star, and you're headed where? Into the streets?
I don't know. It's early in the day, right? It's like just after morning.
Indeed.
The sun is out here.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't we go to a populated area? They're less likely to attack us straight out in a populated area.
Are we sure?
Well, we're not, but...
What part of town are we in? I'm just gonna...
You are center downtown.
Oh, geez.
You are ground zero downtown.
I say we go northwest toward the European district.
Okay. Yeah, we have somebody for you to check out.
Let's get clear first.
Right.
Yeah, when we get to the corner, I mean, I'm in full paranoid mode. Like, I'm just, mm-hmm. I'm looking for, they were wearing a red, was it red? It's red, right? Red or orange, some sort of colored head wrap.
We've run into mm-hmm. red hat guys before, yeah, in New York.
Well, they had the scarves or belts in New York, but... Oh, none of us actually saw the... Whoever saw the caster, I thought the caster had on the train had...
I did. Okay. I saw them while they were working, but there was a lot of fire and smoke. So...
okay.
Look, they were watching the newspaper pretty intense.
So you're heading northwest. Out in the streets and then...
I mean, at this point, I'm pretty familiar with how to get to the rich area. So mm-hmm. I follow the money.
So... Going northwest from the paper, you get about a block, maybe a block, when the roof of the Nairobi Star erupts in flame.
Jesus. I kind of stand there dumbfounded. I don't.
I will grab his arm and keep us moving.
Okay. You continue to move. You're heading northwest, so you're going towards, at this point, for your reference point, Mr. Drummond, you're going towards Dalton and Son Trading Post. That's sort of the direction you're lining up at. You would also know from your time there that you're actually not far from the Central Police Station at that point.
Police station sounds like a fine place to go.
What erupts behind the investigators is... a conflagration. Unbeknownst to most of the people who are here, because they don't see it from the angle which you all do, a pillar of fire hits the Nairobi Star.
It's more of the monsters.
And the building erupts in flames.
Yeah. It's like our only option is not to talk to anybody.
Well, and on that bombshell, I think it's time to end. So thank you all so much for joining us on this episode of Masks of Nyarlathotep. We greatly appreciate your listening ears, and we hope that you're enjoying this fiery Kenya chapter as much as your keeper is. Thank you, and good night.